a groan of tedium escapes me, startling the fearful. Is this a test?
Well, the disappointment parade that is Florida State Seminole football rolls on in 2019. Year two under new head coach Willie Taggart. Listen, last year was an abject failure. There's no other way to describe it. It's absolutely pitiful and pathetic for a team as talented as Florida State to go 5-7. There's no excuse you can make. There's not. Florida State and Southern Cal in the same boat. There is never a reason where Florida State and Southern Cal can't even get bowl eligible. It's absolutely ridiculous. Even Florida State fans agree and wouldn't argue with that point. In today's video, we're going to take a look at Florida State for the 2019 season. We're going to talk about a few pieces they lost from last year, a few of the new pieces they're getting in for this year, and then we're going to take a look at the schedule and try to come up with like a best case, worst case scenario for Florida State football in 2019. I do a detailed version of these videos over the summer, and of course we're doing that again this year. That'll start towards the end of June, where I go through these team schedule and give you a winner and a loser for every single game. Not necessarily going to do that in this video. What we do is we try to take a look at the schedule and figure out, okay, if everything goes right, maybe they can win this many games. If everything goes wrong, maybe they only win this many games. So, yeah, the other group of videos will still be coming out over the summer, but we're doing a whole series of these best case, worst case. This one comes as a request from Jordan C. Jordan, I really appreciate you supporting the channel over on the Uncle Lou Patreon page. It really does mean a lot to me, and I hope you enjoy today's video. After this Florida State video, there's only one more best case, worst case scenario video for me to do from the suggestions over on the Patreon page. So if you're a Patreon member and you have yet to comment on that post on the Patreon page about which team you want to see me do, make sure you hurry up and do that. After I finish up with today's video and the last one that's on the list, then I'm going to move on to doing some of the other teams that I've seen suggested in the comment section on a lot of these videos that I've been doing. So, yeah, there will still be a lot more of these best case, worst case scenario videos. There's still a lot of teams that I want to cover. All right, let's get on with today's video. Real quick before we start, Throwback Thursday, and shout out to my dude, Lou Jr. This is from a few years ago. Of course, for those of you that have been following the channel for a while, you know he's moved on to soccer now. He plays soccer instead of baseball, but he played baseball for 3 or 4 years from the time he was 4 years old till the time he was 7 or 8 or whatever, and I got to coach him a few of those years, and I'll never forget that. I grew up playing baseball and football, and I never played soccer. So it was a little rough on me when he decided that he wanted to move from baseball to soccer, but I've come around now. I'm a soccer fan now. If you guys are parents, sort of know how this works. Whatever your kid is into, you sort of automatically become a fan of that. So, I'm not upset or disappointed that he doesn't play baseball anymore, but, I came across this picture today and I figured I'd share it with you guys. If you have kids and you ever have an opportunity to coach your kid in whatever it is, whether it's t-ball, this was minor league, so this was player pitch baseball here where this picture is from. The Twins was the name of his team, but if you ever have a chance to coach a kid in something, whether it's baseball, soccer, football, basketball, whatever it is, take the opportunity. If I live to be 500 years old, I'll never forget those couple of years that I was able to do that with my son Lou Jr. It really was a lot of fun. I'm not able to coach him in soccer. I mean, I could, but I just don't know enough about soccer to really provide any type of benefit to the kids on the team in terms of learning the game and stuff like that. So I've had to sort of learn how to sit on the sidelines, which isn't easy, especially for Uncle Lou. I spend a lot of time pacing back and forth at these soccer games. I'm getting off subject here. I probably should have saved this story for a live show, but what the hell, just real quick here. But when you're used to coaching like I was in baseball, or when you're just like me in general and you tend to get upset real easily, it's hard to sit on the sidelines and watch your kid do things and think that you know better than what the coaches know or whatever. So I spend a lot of time at Lou Jr. soccer games sort of pacing back and forth. Sometimes I have to get up and just walk away to keep myself from yelling at people. But shout out to Lou Jr. That's my dude. All right, Florida State 2019, what can we expect from Willie Taggart and the Seminoles year two? Let's recap last year just real quick. Of course, everyone knows 5-7, 3-5 in the ACC, finished 6th in the Atlantic. absolutely pitiful. The only team they finished ahead of was Louisville, who also had an epically bad year, right? Florida State and Louisville were two of the worst teams in the Power Five last year. Florida State did end up, of course, beating Louisville, but two really bad teams. Florida State, just no excuse for this. Losses to Virginia Tech, Syracuse, Miami, NC State, Florida, and of course Notre Dame and Clemson. So, I mean, listen, a lot of people would have lost to Clemson last year, right? Notre Dame was an okay team, but there's just never a scenario really where Florida State should be losing games in the same season to teams like NC State, Syracuse, Virginia Tech, blah, blah, blah. I mean, it's just pitiful. Again, this isn't a trash talk video here, and I'm not saying anything that Florida State fans wouldn't agree with. You got to get this turned around quick, fast, and in a hurry if you're Florida State. Can they do it? Well, let's find out. Willie Taggart in his second year, right? Damn phone beeping again. Shut up. Good morning, though. Willie Taggart in his second year, right? He's got to get it turned around really, really quick. The patience in Tallahassee is not very long when it comes to sitting around looking at five-win seasons. They were hugely disappointed the year before Jimbo Fisher's last year when they went 7-5. So you can only imagine the frustration having to sit back and watch a 5-7 season. Of course, the offense was absolutely terrible. Everyone knows that. The offensive line, one of the worst, probably the worst in all of the Power Five, Florida State's offensive line, the last 2 years. Tennessee would give them a run for their money. Their offensive line is non-existent too, but Florida State's offensive line is historically bad. They got to get that fixed. Your first losing record last year since 1976. First time you missed a bowl game, according to Florida State, since 1981. Now, I'm not going to get into the argument about the vacated deal when you were cheating and doing things you weren't supposed to do and you had to vacate a bowl game. I'm not going to get into whether that interrupted your bowl streak or not. That's not the point. So for the purposes of this video, we'll go with 81, although I disagree with you. Yeah, your defense. This kind of surprised me. If you've heard me talk at all about Florida State and how their season went last year, maybe you've heard me talk about it in some other videos. I gave their defense some credit. I said, listen, the defense was pretty good. You know, they would sort of give up a lot of times in the second half because the offense just wasn't doing anything at all. And then, you know, sort of the second half of the season, I mean, you just can't expect the defense to just play at that level all year long while the offense is just bringing nothing to the table. Maybe I had the wrong idea about Florida State's defense. I don't know. You gave up more points per game last year than any other FSU team in history. I still think your defense was the better of the two sides of the ball. I think your defense was better than your offense from the games that I watched, which was four or five probably, just be honest here. Did I watch every single Florida State game? No. Watched four or five, though. Watched the Virginia Tech game, watched the Miami game, watched the Clemson game, watched the Notre Dame game, and watched probably parts of a few more. Most points in school history per game you gave up. Hard to justify that. So maybe I was giving the defense a little bit too much credit, which is not good news for Florida State. The defense, it looks like, isn't even close to where it needs to be. You bring in a new offensive coordinator, of course, Kendall Briles. Boy, this guy should be a good fit at Florida State, shouldn't he? He's at Baylor, wasn't he? Yeah, he was at Baylor. Well, they cover up rapes there, cover them up at Florida State too. But again, this isn't a trash talk video. Just pointing out things to make sure we're historically accurate here. But let's give Kendall Briles some credit, all jokes aside. When he was at Baylor, they were one of the top 10 offenses in the country. When he was at Houston, they were one of the top 10 offenses in the country. And when he was at FAU, they were one of the top 10 offenses in the country. Now, Baylor's had a lot of good offenses, and if you want to give the credit for that to Art Briles, fine. Houston, top 10 offense in the country at Houston, that's not easy to do. FAU, there's other things you can point to there to maybe say that's why they had some success offensively. But you can't argue with this. The guy's been with three teams, all three of them top 10 offenses. So this is a good hire, I think. If he can be a decent human being, and we'll give him the benefit of the doubt there, this is a good hire, I think, at offensive coordinator. Now, I don't think this is a cure-all for Florida State, because I think their offensive issues go way deeper than who was calling the plays. And we'll talk some about that. Of course, DeAndre Francois, he's gone. I'll talk briefly about that situation. He was accused of domestic assault. It was recorded. Everyone heard it and saw the video, I'm sure. He was kicked off the team. And then a few days later, the girl that was involved, who refused to press charges, by the way, on her Instagram account, this big long apology was posted saying she sort of exaggerated the whole incident because she was just mad at him and she didn't really want him to get kicked off the team or to get arrested. She just wanted the cops to kind of show up and scare him a little and blah, blah, blah. And then the girl's sister came out and said that Instagram post was fake and that her Instagram account was hacked. I don't know what happened. Now, you can listen to the audio from the video yourself, and it's pretty clear to see that DeAndre Francois was probably, I don't know, I try to be careful about these situations here. He was obviously pissed off and mad. Now, whether he should have been kicked off the team and blackballed, and I mean, that's a different video for a different day, but nevertheless, he's out. That leaves you with James Blackman. This guy, James Blackman, now he's got a huge arm. He's got a big-time arm. I just don't know if this guy can make it through a season behind Florida State's offensive line. I don't know if this guy can make it through a season behind anyone's offensive line. This guy weighs about 165 pounds, soaking wet. If I can remember, I'll put a picture up on the screen so you guys can see it. He's just one of the thinnest college players I've ever seen at any position. Look at his frame. I don't know how much weight you could possibly put on this guy. And when you have one of the worst offensive lines in America, I'm not sure it's good to have a 160-pound quarterback back there running for his life. We'll see. The problem is that's pretty much all you have. Willie Taggart hasn't signed a quarterback in either of his first two recruiting classes in Tallahassee. Now, he didn't have a whole lot of time for the last one in 2018. So if you want to make an excuse for that, that's fine. But 2019 has come and gone. He had a whole year to develop that class. He signed zero quarterbacks. Now they do have a commit, a big time commit for the 2020 class, but that's not helping them. That's not helping them this year at all. You got a new offensive line coach, and you're going to have some new offensive line players. But again, it is hard for me to have a whole lot of faith right now in Florida State's offensive line until I'm proven wrong. You can't overestimate how bad Florida State's offensive line has been the last 2 years. So until I see a difference on the field, it's hard for me to have a lot of faith in Florida State's offensive line. We'll see. They did sign some offensive linemen. They got a transfer in from somewhere. I think it was offensive line. They got a transfer in. Anyway, it doesn't matter. Point is, they'll have some new offensive linemen. Hard to imagine they could be any worse than they have been. We'll see how much better they can be, though. That's one of the biggest questions, right? You lose your best player on the team, defensive end Brian Burns. He left early to go to the NFL. But you've got some defensive talent. I still think Florida State's defense is good enough to win them a lot of games. Now, the offense has got to score some points, obviously. But I still think Florida State doesn't have a five-win defense, okay? They have a five-win offense. They might have a three- or four-win offense. Last year they did. The defense is way better than a five-win defense, and I still feel that way. Sucks to lose your best player. He had by far the most sacks on your team. I think the next closest guy only had three or something. He had close to like 70% of the sacks for your entire team last year. So it's going to be tough to replace that guy, but you got a lot of talent, particularly along the defensive front and linebacker. So we'll see how that works out. Your last two recruiting classes, which were, of course, Willie Taggart's two recruiting classes. His first year, 2018, the 11th ranked class. This past year, going the wrong way at 18. And again, like I mentioned, signed no quarterbacks at all. Now, they did sign some good players. A top 20 classes is still good. I mean, let's not kid ourselves here. A top 20 classes are still pretty good, but not where Florida State really wants to be. And one of the biggest sort of selling points that Florida State fan tried to tell us when they hired Willie Taggart is that he's a great recruiter. He's an excellent recruiter. He has all these ties to the state of Florida. So far, that really hasn't paid off. I'm of the opinion that pretty much anybody can coach one of the three big schools in Florida and get a top 20 recruiting class. So I haven't seen the so-called Willie Taggart effect in terms of recruiting so far in his first two classes. We'll see if he can get it turned around. I mentioned the big-time quarterback that's committed for 2020, so we'll see what happens going forward. But are the 18th and the 11th ranked class terrible? No. But are they really anything to get excited about at Florida State? Not really. You should be having top 10 classes there. That's just my opinion. You have a national title not that long ago, 2013, right? You win 10 games almost every single year, the last couple of years being the obvious exceptions. But you should be recruiting. You're in the state of Florida. You're the most recent team there to have a national title. You should be recruiting in the top 10. I don't think Florida State fan would argue with that either. So these numbers have got to improve on recruiting. All right, let's throw the schedule up on the screen. We'll take a look at it. You guys know the routine. We'll run through it real quick, and then we'll take a look at some different things concerning the schedule. We'll look at away games. Those sometimes can be tricky. We'll look at non-con games. We'll look at the toughest three stretch period of games, toughest three games in a row, and we'll see if there's any possible trap games on here. All right, you open up the season with a neutral site game, sort of, in Jacksonville, Georgia's home away from home down there. Yeah. Against Boise State. The Smurfs there. Coming to Jacksonville to take on Florida State week one. Boise State is, we all know what Boise State is, right? They're one of the best teams that's not in the Power Five year in and year out. They haven't been as good as Central Florida lately, but they had a run where they were, right? You guys remember 10 so years ago, they were making BCS games. There was the famous Fiesta Bowl where they beat Oklahoma with the sort of Statue of Liberty type. Play a lot of trick plays ran in that game by Boise State, a hook and ladder at one point. Anyway, you probably remember that game against Oklahoma. You definitely remember it if you're a land thief, right? Right, Oklahoma fan? Yeah, that's right. But anyway, so an interesting game, I think. You'd like to see Florida State playing one of the big boys or whatever in a non-con, but this is not a terrible game here. And considering the sort of state of Florida State football right now, I'm sure Florida State fans would much rather be playing Boise State than one of your other big type Power Five teams. So a game that I think Florida State fans are going to expect to win. I don't think it's a gimme, but I think Florida State is the better team. I'll say that. All right, and then you come home, you play Louisiana Monroe. They're a nobody. Then your ACC schedule starts. You got to go on the road and play Virginia. This will not be an easy game. I like Virginia. Virginia was a better team than you last year, in my opinion. That's not an opinion. It's a fact. And I like their coach, although I will admit it's taken him longer to get things going at Virginia than I thought it would. I like Fuentes. He was at Memphis before that. When the whole Mark Richt thing was going on at Georgia and, people were wanting him gone in 14 and 15, he was finally fired, of course, in 15. But there was a period of time back then where I was looking at Justin Fuentes and going, I wouldn't mind maybe getting him in Athens. Of course, I'm happy where we landed with Kirby Smart. But the point is, I like Fuentes. I think he can do some good things at Virginia. Virginia has a ceiling. Let's be real. This would be a stepping stone job for Fuentes. If he gets to the point where he's winning 10 games a couple of years in a row at Virginia, he's gone from there, and he'll have a bigger he'll be coaching at a bigger name school. But right now they're better than you, and you got to play them on the road. That's not an easy game for you. You come home and play Louisville. You should win that game. They got new coaching staff there. They were as worse, maybe even more worse. More worser even, maybe even the worst assist than you last year. So you got to figure that's probably a win. NC State at home. NC State's one of these teams kind of hard to judge. I mean, they win 9-10 games 1 year, turn around, win 5 or 6, something like that. I think you're better than them. We'll see. That takes you into a bye week. Come out of your bye week, got to go on the road and play at Clemson. Listen, you could have 4 bye weeks. It wouldn't matter. I'm sorry. Clemson is night and day ahead of you right now. You have absolutely zero chance in this game. I'm sorry. You're not winning that. You're just not winning it. On the road at Clemson? No. Not this year. Not happening. Sorry. Then you got to turn around again and go on the road at Wake Forest. This is a trap game here because Wake Forest is not a very good team, right? You're better than them, but you're going to be beat up after that Clemson game. And then the following week, you got to play Syracuse. And Syracuse is a good ACC team. And there ain't very many of them, right? Clemson is elite. Syracuse is good. Who else was good in the ACC last year? The list ain't very long, but Syracuse is on that list. I don't think that's a gimme either. The Syracuse game, don't get caught sleeping. This Wake game sort of sandwiched in between two of your tougher games, honestly. Clemson and Syracuse, and then you got to play Miami. So this is a difficult 4 stretch of games, in my opinion. We talked about a tough 3 game stretch, but at Clemson, at Wake Forest, home against Syracuse, home against Miami, 3 of those teams are probably going to be favored against you. Honestly, you may be favored against Wake, maybe Syracuse, but I doubt it. I mean, you're definitely going to be an underdog to Clemson and Miami. Miami, of course, the biggest game of the year if you're a Florida State fan, big rivalry. Now, they beat you last year by, what, 1 point, I think. And, of course, they weren't very impressive last year either. They've got a new coach in this year, Manny Diaz. This will be an interesting game to keep an eye on. Obviously, it is every single year. Then you go on the road at Boston College, home against Alabama State. Your second bye week. You get two bye weeks. I mention this in every one of these videos I do. It's not a change. There's not going to be two bye weeks all the time now. This is just the way the calendar falls this year. In order to start the season when they normally start it and have the conference championship games the first Saturday of December like they always do, requires two bye weeks. That's why that is. And then your last game of the year on the road at Florida. Florida will be a top 10 team in the preseason. We'll see where they're at by the time you play them here. Tell you right now, they're going to have at least one loss, though. Yep, without a problem. Georgia will show you how to get it done, but you got to play them there. I mean, this game's a long time away. Obviously, we'll have a lot more information about this game when it's played than we do now. You have 11 games to look at. But, I mean, if you look at this game right now, Florida's a 14 to 17 point favorite, in my opinion, right now. Now, that could change, of course, by the time this game is played, but most people are going to tell you that Florida is at least a couple of touchdowns better than you right now, I think. All right, so your non-con, Boise State, I think you can win that game, but I don't think it's a gimme. Louisiana Monroe, you should roll. What else do we have here? Alabama State, you should roll in that one. Shouldn't be too much of a problem for you to go ahead and do that. Florida, you'll be a big underdog. So that's what your non-con looks like. Road games, which can sometimes be tricky. At Virginia, I think that'll be a tough game for you. At Clemson, you have no chance to win. At Wake Forest, that's a game you've got to try to win this year. At Boston College, another game you got to try to win this year. And at Florida, a game I don't think you're going to win. Okay? Toughest stretch of games, we already sort of mentioned that. Clemson, Wake Forest, Syracuse, and Miami. You played them 4 weeks in a row without a bye week. The first two are on the road, Clemson and Wake Forest. Then you play Syracuse and Miami at home. If you go 3-1 there, I think a lot of people will be surprised. 2-2, I think, is what is expected. I think it's possible you could go 1-3. Again, this is a best case, worst case thing. So I'm not predicting you to go 1-3 in that 4-game stretch. I'm just saying. Trap games at Wake Forest. I mean, typically you would say Syracuse only because you play them the week before Miami, but I think Syracuse is a good. Syracuse is better than Miami, in my opinion. That could change this year, but last year they were definitely better than Miami last year, I think. I guess I'll go with this Wake Forest game as a potential trap game. But all right, best case, worst case. If everything goes right for Florida State this year, 9-3? I mean, I'll just tell you right now, I don't think there's any way you beat Clemson, and I don't think there's any way you beat Florida. I'll just tell you that. And I know Florida. I hate Florida, okay? I just don't think you're beating them this year. So I think that's two losses no matter what. I don't trust Willie Taggart to win all the remaining games, even if you're favored in all of them, which you won't be, okay? Boise State, Miami, Syracuse, you're losing one of those games, I'm willing to bet. That puts you at 9-3. I'm going to say that's the best case scenario, 9-3. I think if you don't get the offensive line situation straightened out, and Blackman's not as good as you hope he is, and the defense doesn't get back to what, you know, we're used to seeing a Florida State defense do, and Cam Akers can't carry you. Cam Akers has a ton of talent. I should have mentioned him in the beginning. I love Cam Akers. He's an NFL running back, but let's be with that offensive line. And, I mean, he's your entire offense, or at least he was last year. So we'll see. But worst case scenario, though, one. Two, three. I'm going to say 6-6. I think you make a bowl game this year no matter what. And I'm not predicting you to go 6-6, just like I'm not predicting you to go 9-3. I think those are the best case, worst case scenarios for Florida State this year. I know Florida State fan does not want to hear 9-3 as a best case scenario. Believe me, I get it. It's April. Everyone's undefeated with the tradition that Florida State has over the last 30 years. They don't want to know heading into a season that 9 wins is the absolute ceiling for them, but that's how I feel. And you've got to look at things in the context that they're in now. You went from 7 wins to 5 wins in the last 2 seasons. If you can take that 5 and turn it into a 9, would Florida State be satisfied with a 9-win season? No, but it would be a huge step in the right direction, right? And then hopefully 2020, that quarterback that shows up is ready to go day one, because, you know, if you lose Blackman, just forget it. You may not win a game. You just got nobody to replace him, in my opinion. I won't say that. Everybody's got options. Everybody's got backups, walk-ons, transfers. I get all that, but let's just be real. Your quarterback depth right now, not that great. Anyway, that's it. I appreciate you guys watching. Give this video a thumbs up if you enjoyed it. I would appreciate it, and it really helps me a lot and doesn't take you long at all to do. Subscribe to the Uncle Lou channel if you're not already. I post college football videos almost every single day of the year, and sometimes they're even watchable, although not too sure about this one. Have a great day.